Happy Halloween, folks. My name is Don, and today I will be your guide to all things that go snickersnack in Alice Madness Returns, the sequel to American McGee's Alice, a game from the year 2000 that became a bit of a cult classic, a bit of a cult favorite because of its interesting interpretation of the Alice in Wonderland fiction. This is kind of a soft sequel. You don't have to have played the first game to really appreciate what goes on in this. There are a few references, there are a few mentions of things that happened before, some of which will be covered in this video. But I just wanted to show this off because I don't really have many horror games as such, but I wanted to play something for Halloween, and this is the closest I have to a super spoopy game. So, we're gonna play this instead. Hope you enjoy, folks. So what I'm doing right now is I'm showing you the best fucking bits of this game because I love it. It's kind of old now, so spoilers, it's not so much of an issue at the moment, but I'm going to try and stay away from story spoilers. I'm just showing you the coolest bits like this shit. So this is about 3/4 into the game. Alice needs to find the Red Queen, who was the main antagonist of the previous game. The last time we saw her, Alice blew her the fuck up with the blunderbuss, actually. Yeah, that was awesome. So as you play both real-world Alice, who exists in Victorian London, and Wonderland Alice, who's a more sort of confident version of herself. And I'm about to show you probably one of the most beautiful things I've ever played in a video game. This whole level, the music, everything, it's just incredible. So much work has gone into this, the gameplay as well. The first game was sensibly a 3D platforming game. Where am I meant to go? I'm gonna go down there. And this game sort of obviously takes cues from that. It maintains the whole platforming aspect, but it adds in a few extra little twists. For example, shrink sense. So the idea here is that Alice at will can shrink, and when she does, she sees things that she wouldn't ordinarily be able to see. For example, over here, there are platforms that I can jump on. And even when I'm not using shrink sense, I can still jump on them, they're still there. And so there's bonuses and things, you can collect items and whatever that you wouldn't ordinarily, be able to see. Whoops. Which adds like a really interesting mechanic to the game. There's loads of collectibles. You can probably see I'm collecting teeth. That's sort of one of the main pickups. You spend them to upgrade your weapons and things, and it's really rather cool. And there's all this stuff as well. Boing. Yeah, really beautiful game. The music, I can't remember. The first game had Chris Vrenna, I believe, doing the music. Oh wait, is this the bit that? Yeah. Whoa. Yeah, the first game had Chris Vrenna, who some people may know from, I believe, Nine Inch Nails or Manson, Marilyn Manson, I can't remember, where he... Oh shit, what did that do? Oh. Did it do this? Oh, it did that. Right, I know what it did. I need to get over there quickly before those cars disappear. They're gonna do it. Yeah, no. Ah, yes. And hopefully I'll show you a little bit of the combat soon coming up. This is a very quiet level, nothing really happens here. Yeah, you bastard, right? It's so good for fucking with you. It's such a great game. I keep getting off track because I'm just distracted by how gorgeous this game is. Things like the music, I mean, you can probably hear the music, and I'm going to shut up for a second. Oh, actually, yeah, this is the end of the level. I can't show you any more of the music. But hopefully you've been listening to the music anyway. It is amazing, and it's like this for the whole game. The music and the art style is incredible. So this has been great and everything, but this was just a sort of transitional level while we make our way to the Queen's Domain. So let's go and see that, shall we?
Back to admire your handiwork, returning to the scene of the crime.
It had to be done, Cat. You said so yourself. You and this Red Queen cannot both survive. She is a cancer in your body. excise her or perish?
Well, she was the face of evil in the heart of darkness.
She didn't treat you too well last time, lost your head as I recall.
She was completely deranged. You picked up her crown, but now you've put it down. You must speak to her, what's left of her anyway.
Oh my god, the guy who does Jess's voice. Amazing, completely amazing. In the first game, he also did the voice of the Jabberwock, who was an asshole. So you can see already the platforming gets pretty intense. Whoa. And now we're going to see a bit of the combat. If the camera would stop wigging out. Alright. Bring it, you fucker. Oh, yeah, right. So I'm using some of the DLC weapons as well, because they're just stronger. You may hear me hammering on the controller, and you may see me make a couple of fatal errors, because I've been playing a lot of Transformers Devastation game, and my head is totally in that mode of combat, which is very different from this mode of combat. Again, I wanted to play something scary, but I don't have any horror games. I don't really play horror games. I don't really like horror games. They don't really scare me that much. This game, though, it's not that it's scary, it's that it's kind of disturbing. For instance, this shit. Now, it's not the fact that he's, you know, a skeletal card creature thing. It's the fact that this is what's become of the Red Queen's army since the last game. These are effectively the same enemies you killed in the first game, but now they're zombified. Which is just cool. I mean, I don't know, and you think about it, when I think about it like that, I'm really fucking impressed. They become more than just, you know, straight up enemies. You just, ow, fuck off.
The Red Kingdom's in ruins, but you're no better off.
When you defeated her, I tried to reclaim the castle, but I was set upon by her monstrosities. The malignant royal bitch still reigns.
I'm here to petition her. I must get inside.
The only way in is through me. Sacrifices must be made.
Those who say so usually mean they should be made by others.
Cynicism is a disease. It can be cured. Once inside, beware of the outsized killer who patrols her domain. Never confront him. He is invincible. Now cut me loose. I'll show you the meaning of sacrifice.
Oh dear. The game's full of this kind of stuff. Oh, you know what, actually? I don't want to go into the main plot stuff, because the main plot is actually pretty good. I was kind of surprised when I realized what was really going on in the game, and there's a lot of... Because for the most part, you don't even realize what the story is about until probably the last chapter. And it's not a twist or anything, it's just like, oh, fucking hell, for real. Hey, look, it's the Red Queen from the first game. Well, it's not, actually. That one turned out to be a puppet. And the real Red Queen was this, like... when I say Red Queen, by the way, I do mean Queen of Hearts as well. Same character in this game. In the books, it wasn't. They were two separate characters. But here, the Red Queen is used to refer to both the Red Queen and... What's her face? Queen of Hearts. So this came out in 2011, I want to say, because it was meant to be like 10 years after the first game, and then it kind of got delayed or something, I can't remember. And so this was a 2010-2011 game, and it was really cool for kind of going back to the retro classic platforming kind of gameplay. Oh, double shits. Yeah, so I should probably show the weapons. So, like, this is the teapot cannon. I'm using the Cheshire skin for it. Usually it's an actual teapot. And it fires this ball of molten tea, basically. Then you've got the pepper grinder. Ordinarily, this would just be a pepper grinder, but DLC pack gives you the octo gun skin. I don't think that's what it's called. You got the hobby horse. Usually it's just a normal hobby horse, but obviously it's got antlers now because DLC. Here's the bottle. It's mine now. And then, of course, you've got your Vorpal Blade, or Vorpal Cleaver in this case. I really was going to use just the normal Vorpal Blade because it's her signature weapon and everything, but I wanted to have a good time while playing this. The base game weapons are dog shit for the most part. That said, there is an upgrade system. I'll show you that in a second as well. But this is going to get really, really complicated, so I'm going to have to wait, I'm afraid. Whoa! again, it's like when you know what you're doing with the combat, it's one of those games where you can go through a fight and actually not get touched. And that's when you know you've got fucking skills, you know? And I'm not even locked on. Up yours, bitch. Right, this asshole. So folks watching Matt's Resident Evil 3 playthrough will be familiar with this concept. Basically, this guy is gonna chase me all the way through this fucking level like an ass.
I'm an idiot. Don Quixote has a better chance with his windmills, and without risk of decapitation.
A prudent exit is no less so for being hasty.
Yeah. Let me out. Yeah, that's it. Just close the door on him. That'll keep him. Oh, look. And then you get this bullshit. And there's really no skill to this. You just hold and go, whoa, fuck you. Yeah, shut up, fucker.
A weapon's intended function is almost beside the point. Ultimately, it's only as good as the person who wields it.
Yeah, so throughout the game, you also pick up these little memories which relate to things that the characters have said to Alice, and they all kind of hint towards what's really going on. Now, I'm going to try and avoid, in this level, there's one or two that really do hint at what's really going on, and I kind of want to avoid them. So I'm not going to pick any more of those up, if you guys don't mind. Seriously, go play the fucking game if you want to know what's up.
The Queen's Guardian rarely leaves his filthy lair. But you're special.
I am going to do this whole level, by the way, because it is my favorite, and it has all the best... it just has the best bits from the game. A lot of it at the beginning, the first sort of half of it is this, basically. It's kind of puzzles and floating around and whatever, but the second half... that is awesome, and I'm going to show you, I'm going to show you that. For those hardcore players out there, you should probably know that the hobby horse, with every successful hit, replenishes my health. So if you think I'm cheating or whatever, I am. Essentially, I am fucking cheating. Deal with it. Now, these fucking things. So there's a couple of these puzzles. I'll try to get blast through these as fast as possible because they're really not that great. Basically, I have to get over there by doing these things, but when you put weight on these things, they go down. Which helps you do stuff like that. So I'm just going to get through this as fast as possible because I'm a fucking genius. I know how to do this first time. Watch. I fucking do it first time. Yeah, I really wish I had the first game to hand because I would love to do a playthrough. I never actually finished it. I remember cheating my way through it. I'm glad I mentioned that because this is also a bit you can cheat your way through. So a couple of levels have these kind of mini games in them. And basically, if you just kind of fail at them, you can skip them. So I couldn't possibly fail that one. I would feel bad about myself if I did. So basically, you know, I'll just do this. Oh no, wait, hang on. Oh god. Right. So I can skip it. And there's a couple of games like that, and you don't have to finish them, and I don't think I ever have finished that one. The plot is fine. Oh, you know what I should say. About half of this game's fucking missing, okay? Just be warned. There's some stuff that doesn't make any fucking sense because EA had to come in and meddle, and I'll probably get my video taken down just for fucking saying that. I feel so bad for American McGee because, you know, he clearly had a certain vision for this game. But there's a trailer out there. I can't remember which one it is. It might be called What Have You Done? Or, like, I think it's called that. I don't know. But basically, there's a trailer where about 75%, and maybe I'm exaggerating a little bit, maybe like 74%. 74% of the footage in the trailer isn't present, of the content in the trailer isn't present in the game. And it's really sad because it's half the plot. I mean, I can probably just tell you since it's not in the game, so it's not even a spoiler, I guess, but there's a whole subplot that's heavily hinted at in the trailer regarding Alice, what she's doing in the real world when she's in Wonderland. What is hinted at in the opening cutscene to this video, where she's in jail, is that she kills people, basically, in the real world while she's in Wonderland. That the people she meets in the real world manifest in Wonderland as whoever or whatever. And when she kills in Wonderland, she's actually also killing them in real life, you know, in that kind of way. Oh, damn it, I dodged. And the whole plot is gone from this game. In the trailer, in that one trailer, there's like scenes of her in London getting chased across rooftops by the police. That's not in the game. That's not in the fucking game. It's just gone. It's all gone. There's so much missing, and it's so heartbreaking because it's clear this game could have literally been twice the game it is, and even the game it is very good. So more of it, yeah, that would have been great. Even if they'd, hell, if they'd released it as like DLC or whatever, I'd have paid for it. Hell yeah, I'd have paid for it. So it's not like out of laziness that they decided to cut half the game out or anything. Like, I just don't believe that. Whee! So it's just really sad that, you know, that once again, someone's creative vision couldn't see the light of day because of executive meddling. Oh, this is stupid. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Fucking run. Get away from that guy. Fuck you, you can't jump down here. You have to go around. Ha ha ha. Warped AI. Oh shit, he's coming back. Fuck. Go. Oh, hello. You're a bit. Whoa. Fuck, I didn't see you there. Just gotta dodge this shit. Get out of my way! Yeah, sometimes I find it's better to play with the auto-lock off, because Alice has a tendency to get stuck killing certain enemies who you don't actually want her to kill. So these things have three of these faces. They're kind of the weak spots on these enemies. You can see he's covering it now. So the trick is to get in there and kind of shoot that thing off. And as soon as you do all three of them, he's dead anyway. So that's cool. Oh! No, could you? Yeah, ha ha ha, so funny, asshole.
A reflection sometimes exposes more reality than the object it echoes.
I remember there was, for the first game, the Alice website had a mini-game on it where you could ask Cheshire a question, and he would come out with these cryptic answers, and that was one of them. Can I go to exit? Yeah, skip this shit. Oh, right, and then there's that thing. God damn, that thing is made of nightmares. It's... Oh, fucking hell, I wish I could have shown you that a little bit better. There's a train that's just blasting its way through Wonderland. There is a reason for it. Oh, it's coming back. I can hear it. Dickhead. Yeah, there's a train that's just, like, charging through Wonderland, destroying everything. And, it is explained later on, but it's, oh my god, it's so good. It's just, like I said, it really is made of fucking nightmares. It's just like a massive gothic cathedral on wheels. It's terrifying. I said I would show it to you, so I'm going to show it to you. The weapons menu. Right, so this is it. Basically, you can upgrade your weapons by spending teeth to upgrade them. I still have enough. I could upgrade that again. Thing is, I'm not using any of these weapons. I'm using the DLC ones. So I want to upgrade this one, because the level 4 one is much cooler. And, oh, I ain't got enough anymore. Well, that was fun, wasn't it, kids? My god, I am not doing too well here. Get off! Damn it! Suck a fucking chode, you ass bag! Oh god! Ugh! That's right. See, again, most of the fuck-ups are my fuck-ups. I should be faster at this. I should be better at this, yeah. I should really break his arms off as well, actually. How do I do that? This guy's pissing me off now. Alright, here's one way to kill him. That's how you do it. Yeah, I was just having a dumb moment. I do know how to do I do know how to play this game. I just forgot that you had to take off those arms first. Because usually just deflect those things straight back at him, and that's like the first thing you do. But of course, playing, you know, fighting against like a million other fucking enemies, you kind of forget. So there's another memory in there, but I'm gonna skip it. It's unsettling, which to me is better than scary. Like, I don't care about scary. Scary, you gotta do it right, and if you don't do it right, you fuck up. And you fuck up bad. You know, a game that's like, boo, and you're like, what? You know, it's like, there's just too much room for it to fail, and that's why I don't really play horror games, because I don't want to cringe. Like the last horror game I played that I found legitimately scary was P.T. That bothered me. Because my buddy, because I don't have a PS4, my buddy, like, gave me the controller, was like, you're playing this. And I didn't like it one bit. I actually didn't finish it. Yeah, that bothered me. I didn't fall for the look behind you thing, I will say that much. I can, you know, I'm proud of that. But for the most part, yeah, I didn't like that one at all. But yeah, like horror games in general, it's just not my thing. I don't really care. So I was a bit lost for what to do for Halloween this year. I say that like I had anything last year. But this is unsettling. That's what I love about it. It's unsettling. It kind of makes you're sort of thinking about it after the fact, which I think is even better. Like, well, that's the whole point of horror, really. It kind of has to be there for your nightmares when you leave the cinema or you stop playing the game or whatever, and you're still kind of bothered by what you saw. That's good. Oh, you know what's coming up. Yeah. This dick. He will get what's coming to him. Right, come on, Alice. Those of you who played the game know what's coming. Those of you who haven't, just watch this. It's so good. It's so good. And then you get to do this. Now, I don't know why her dress changes. I don't know. But that wasn't just a cutscene. You're still big. You're still a giant. You're still giant Alice. And the controls are slightly different now. And, yeah, well, giant. Alice can attack by stomping or pounding. Attack the Queen's Towers to expose her heart. Break down the castle gates that block the way. Sounds like fun. Fuck you. And fuck you. Now, what's kind of a little unsettling about this whole section is these chess pieces in the first game, they were shown to be sentient. They're shown to be, you know, characters. Oh, man. Yeah, just bring it on, you little fuckers. And in this level, you're able to, you know, essentially kill those characters. They seem to be, you know, trapped in some sort of... I mean, that one looks completely decayed, so he's, you know, if that is a person, he's dead. He's definitely dead, so I could just do that without feeling too bad. The others, different story. So that was the maze, and that's where I came from and everything. Oh, it's just... It's rare that a game can give you, like, a whole new perspective on itself. Again, I will at some point be playing Transformers Fall of Cybertron, and in that game you also get to play as, like, a character who's fucking massive, and... stomping on enemies who you previously were the same height as, that's a good feeling. That's a good feeling. Let me through. Now, I can't really dodge this at this point. Oh, fuck you, asshole. Right. But I gotta knock down this tower to expose the heart, and then I just gotta stomp on it. And she don't like that at all. So the queen, in the first game, to kind of illustrate her power and her reach, these tentacle things were present throughout the game, just wrapped around buildings and structures and everything, and they didn't do any damage or anything in the first game. But the implication was that the Queen's body was physically so big and so amorphous, I think is the word, that she was literally present all over Wonderland. Now, in this game, you don't really see those tentacles until that section earlier where you're walking through the corridor and her tentacles are everywhere. And for players who played the first game, that's like... That's a bit of PTSD. You see those tentacles, you know shit's about to go down. You need a drink, you have to wash yourself in it, fucking hell.
You were once two bits of the same psyche, so where does that leave you?
Yeah, So the whole thing was that.
There's no reason to proceed.
Oh, fucking Jesus Christ! Look at that shit. The whole thing was that Alice and the Red Queen were they couldn't coexist. Anyway, that memory right there—that's the biggest spoiler. So I'm gonna skip that. I mean, I'm gonna skip it anyway, but you know, I kind of wish they'd remake the first game like this with some of the. Because the first game was definitely trying to do this, and actually it didn't do such a bad job, but obviously the advanced graphics enabled the artists to have a bit more fun with the design of the game, a bit more ambitious with it. And it's great, and it really is great, but I really wish they'd go back and do the first game like this as well, and hopefully... Oh, fuck a duck. Come on. Oh, yes. And I kind of wish, yeah, they'd go back and do the first game again and just kind of get that up to modern standards. Just because it deserves it, quite frankly. It's a really unsettling game because of how... I can't describe it, but the atmosphere in that game is fucked. It is fucked beyond all reason. It's just weird and unsettling, and stuff doesn't make total sense, but it kind of knows that, and it just takes you with it. You know, if you've ever met a genuine psychopath, psychopath or a sociopath, you know how kind of charismatic they are and how you'll just follow them in spite of knowing that they're very dangerous people. The first game was like that. It was a bit fucked. Like the way it told its story and stuff, it didn't make a lot of sense. It didn't really explain anything to you. It just kind of did it and you went along with it because it did it with such style and grace. Also, if you do have any friends who are psychopaths or sociopaths, leave that shit alone. It's not good for you. Straight up, don't do it to yourself. They aren't worth it. Well, folks, it has been fun. This is pretty much the end of the level at this point. I really hope you've enjoyed it. I really hope I've sold this game to a few people as well. Because it really deserves a little bit more attention. Go check out America McGee on Facebook as well. He's very active, and Twitter is Facebook as well. He's very active. He's still supporting this game and the series, even if EA doesn't fucking want it. I think there's a Kickstarter for a couple of projects he's working on. It's really amazing. Go out and buy it. It's on right now as part of the Halloween thing. It's on sale. It'll probably be on sale every goddamn Halloween. It's probably one of the best horror-ish themed games that EA has. So they're going to milk it. They're going to milk it dry. I'll show you this last cutscene, and then I'm signing off.
I was expecting someone else.
You don't know your own mind!
It's nearly a complete stranger.
What you claim not to know is merely what you've denied. You've recaptured your vagrant memories.
What are you doing with them?
You once rejected my attempts to control our lives forcefully. But now you've allowed another to succeed in my role.
I won't miss your tentacles.
You'd prefer the hot, stinking breath and unyielding attention of a potent, unreasoning, unfeeling Hellraiser? I don't think so.
Can you give me more than a warning? Caterpillar said you might help.
I'd need a better reason to respond than what's currently on offer.
If you don't, we're all doomed.
Not doomed, forgotten. I may survive here, but you're finished. You see the pattern of destruction? I know you do. The train is trying to destroy all evidence of your past, and especially the fire. Now, who would want that? Who benefits from your madness?
The destruction of Wonderland is the destruction of me.
Indeed, and vice versa.
I've set it in motion. I can derail it. This is good for me. I'm not insane. I didn't kill my family. I am fine. I'm not mad. I'm innocent. I mean, not guilty. What's happening? What are you doing?
The train must be stopped, but there's more to do. Your view conceals a tragedy. The whole truth you claim to see eludes you because you won't look at what's around you!
So there we go, folks. That was Alice Madness Returns. I really hope you enjoyed it. Again, I hope I sold this game to a few people because I think American Mickey definitely deserves a little more attention. I love this series. I love the artwork, and it's such a great game. Even if you're not a horror fan, in fact, no, especially if you aren't a horror fan, it's not horror. It's just disturbing, and it's a load of fun as well. I have not shown you all of the best bits. There are still tons to this game, even after EA cut half the fucking game out. Jesus fucking Christ, what are you guys thinking? Even after all that, there is still tons of stuff in this game that is so good that I'm not going to show you, that you absolutely must see for yourself. Either watch a playthrough or whatever. Again, like with the Transformers thing, if there's enough attention or whatever, I might play a bit more of this. It really depends. But for now, that's enough, I think. I've talked about this game quite enough. I hope you guys enjoyed it, and I'll see you all in the next video. Ciao, guys.